time division multiplexing. Previously, we have discussed about frequency division multiplexing. That is, if we have, say, two information messages, I of t, I1 of t and I2 of t. So what we can do is we can multiply it with carrier 1, and we'll multiply this with carrier 2, and then we would sum them up and send it over the air or through a channel. So what it would do is, so if this is our C1 and this is our C2 in frequency domain, so this I1 could be over here and I2 could be over here, right? Different information signals are multiplexed in frequency. So for FDM, multiple information sources are placed in distinct frequency bands like that, and each source has complete transmission time. So for that, what we mean is that if we plot time versus frequency, so say this is our 88 megahertz, this is 89 megahertz and so on, taking an example of FM. So for that, we know that this channel is allocated for all times to one particular station, and similarly this channel is allocated for all times to another particular stations. So the frequency is segregated, but a given channel or a given frequency band is assigned to one specific station, right? So FDM finds application in amplitude modulation as well as in frequency modulation. Presently, we are interested in the alternate scheme, which is time division multiplexing. So again, if we replot this over here and we say we are interested in time with respect to frequency, so we are going to segregate the messages I1 and I2 with respect to time. So I1 is available for a given instant of time, but the whole channel is accessible to it. Similarly, I2 is available for a specific time duration, but again the whole frequency channel F is available to it. This can be summarized as multiple information sources are placed in distinct time instants, and each source has the complete available spectrum or channel. Right, and the applications for such are GSM, that is the 2G networks, and also public switched telephone networks, PSTNs, for which we use pulse code modulation, and we can relate TDM, that is time division multiplexing, multiplexing of different messages or message signals to a given frame. Also, time division multiple access, that is different users can access the same time frame, that is TDMA. Now let us move towards sampling and baseband transmission. First and foremost, time division multiplexing is not for continuous signals. That is quite obvious because we have a given frame in time and we are segregating that frame. Say this is up to 10 seconds, just to keep it simple. So we are segregating it in terms of seconds, 1, 2, 3, so on until 10. So this time period would be allocated to a given message, this would be allocated to maybe the second message, again to the first message, again to the second message, and so on. So for that, we don't we cannot rely on continuous signals, so we have to move towards some other formulation, and that formulation is basically achieved by means of sampling. That is, you sample continuous signals, this would produce discrete signals. So once we achieve the discrete signals, we can employ TDM on it. So primarily the discrete signals are multiplexed in time, an example of which is shown over here. So there exist several methods to achieve time-driven multiplexing. Interleaving and de-interleaving plays a significant role in most methods. I would touch upon interleaving and de-interleaving with the help of an example coming up. So depending on the nature of signals, let us look into two examples. The first one is time-driven multiplexing for periodic signals. And let us resort to a Simulink setup for understanding simple periodic signals. In this example, we would show how two message signals, message signal 1 and message signal 2, can be multiplexed, transmitted, and recovered in the Simulink environment. For reproducibility, all of these blocks are available in the Simulink library over here. You can simply type in the block that you need and you would get the block. So let us start with the message signal 1 first. This is simply a sawtooth wave. This is from the block is the signal generator. So we have a sawtooth. I've set the amplitude equal to 4 and frequency equal to 5 hertz. So the first one is sawtooth wave. The second one is simply a sine wave that has an amplitude of 2 and frequency equal to 5 as before. Right. So I would click on all the blocks so that you could reproduce or you could get all of them from the Simulink library. So this is our clock enable, digital clock, switch. I've set the threshold to 0.5. Right. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 switches. And then we have a delay block, transport delay. I've set the delay to 1. And these are simple scopes, right? And again, we have some delay blocks over here. Some blocks, right? So let us start with the example. So we have a message signal 1 and message signal 2 as described previously, and we also have a clock enable. So this clock enable is having a period of 2. So initially we have a switch which has a threshold of 0.5. so if the clock enable is greater than 0.5, the upper input would be thrown at the output, and if it is less than 0.5, the lower input would be thrown at the output. Note that I have not connected anything to the lower output, so our clock is something like that. And for this time the output would be equal to 0. Similarly, we have a message signal 2 which is fed to the switch in the upper branch, and the clock is relayed in the middle, and we have a lower branch which is set to 0. So again, as per the clock enable, so whenever the value is greater than the threshold 0.5, message signal 2 would be relayed at the output, otherwise 0 would be relayed at the output. So over here, this switch, what it will do is it would cancel this one, and similarly for the second signal, this switch would cancel this one at alternate recurrence. So we would have the sawtooth wave followed by a straight 0 value, and then again a sawtooth wave, and then again a 0 value, and so on. And similarly over here we would have 0 at alternate points. But for TDMA we need something of this sort, that initially we have this message which is followed by this message and so on and so forth. So first sample and second sample is placed over here in the second time slot, then the third one would come here and the fourth one would come after that, and so on. So for that we need a delay for this message signal, and that delay is achieved by means of this block. So that identifies that the time delay is set to 1. Now let us look into the scope. Herein we have the message signal which is appearing over here. This is a sawtooth wave, and this is message signal 2, a simple sine function. At the output of our switch 1, we are getting the third waveform, that is sawtooth followed by a straight line, and then sawtooth followed by a straight line, and so on. Whereas the output of the switch 2 was simply this waveform, but we needed a delay so that this goes over here. The first symbol goes over here, and for that we have used this delay, and this is expressed over here. Right. So as a summary, message signal 1, message signal 2, processed message signal 1 and processed message signal 2. Now what we are interested in is we are interested in the summation of these two, and for that I have again used a switch, and I have enabled the switch by means of a clock enable. And whenever the clock is greater than 0.5, it is going to select message signal 1, otherwise it is going to select the processed message signal 2, right? And the output is relayed to the scope. And over here you can observe that this is our first message signal, the second message signal, again the first, second, and onward. So we have time division multiplexed the two message signals M1 and M2. And this is transmitted over an arbitrary channel, right? The second section of this simulation identifies the receiver side. And for that, again, I have used a switch. So this switch, whenever the clock is enabled, it is going to pick this message. And whenever the value goes below threshold, it would turn to 0. And similarly, for the second switch, the interleaved signal is set to the lower branch. And whenever the threshold is less than 0.5, we'll pick the signal from the interleaved signal. And whenever it is greater than 0.5, it would be set to 0. So this branch is set to scope, and the output of the second, the fifth switch is also sent to the scope. And we can observe that we have now again recovered message signal 1, 2 on two different outputs. So we can observe that message signal 1 and message signal 2 are appearing at two different outputs, but we have these spaces which are undesirable. So for that, since we know that this is periodic signal, for simplicity I have just set this to a summation block, took this signal again and delayed it by 1 unit or 1 second. So this would appear over here and this would appear over here, and finally summed them up to get our first message signal. Similarly, the second is appearing over here as a sine function, and for that I have set the delay again to 1, put the original and the delayed version to a summation block, and eventually this is our second signal, second message signal, delayed by 1 second. So this is an end-to-end example identifying the TDM for two periodic signals. Note that these blocks are only applicable if they are periodic. For aperiodic signals or for random signals, we cannot make use of these blocks. So we have to look into the alternate mechanism.